sure that's rolling. Does it look okay? Okay, yeah, I'm gonna scoot back.
Okay, I just want to go over a couple things. I just want to have everyone together when we talk about this. A couple things on how we're optimizing the way that we're handling contracts and disclosures. And so I've sent out emails about this. I just want to announce it that, so we're all on the same page. When a contract comes in, okay, it's going to go to the loan officer assistant, the LOA, and it's going to go to Mark. So it needs to go on his board when the contract comes in. All right. So let me say that again. When a contract comes in, it's going to go to your LOA, and it has to go to Mark too. Mark has to review at the same time. So there can't be a lag. So it can't go to Priscilliano on the 17th and to Mark on the 23rd. If you get the contract on the 17th and it goes to Priscilliano, it has to go to Mark as well. All right, now Priscilliano is going to prepare the disclosures right there and get them sent out the same day. The goal is that we want the disclosures out the same day that the contract comes in?
Yeah.
Okay. So now where Mark is going to come in and help is before the loan goes into processing. So, and be the gatekeeper for processing to make sure that the file is 100% before it goes into processing. All
right? Right.
Can you extend on what exactly you're going to be looking at and publish?
Documents if somebody's using, whatever they're using for overtime, make sure it's documented 100%. They get certain incomes calculated as well as possible. The overall structure of the loan, and I'm glancing over the contract.
Mm-hmm. And make sure there's a deal there.
Yeah.
Now we did talk about this yesterday, and Joshua brought this up about, and I had proposed it to you to prepare a checklist for the LOA. That way, so we have something standardized, because it seems like there's vagaries between each person on what's acceptable, what's not. I mean, so. What are your thoughts on that?
Oh yeah, it's absolutely something I can do.
I mean, is it sensible?
I think the process would be. I think we need to get our processes down first. As far as documentation, there shouldn't be any variation of what's acceptable. But I mean, yeah, we can review it.
Okay.
Well, I mean, from loan officer to loan officer, I think the variation comes in, like, what one loan officer might have in a file compared to another. For example, I was talking with Jason yesterday, and he was handing a file, but he has a contract in. He didn't want to hand it off to the LOA just yet because the docs he had in it were from November. So he was reaching out to the borrower to get all the updated docs before he can turn it into her, which was really, really good. And I asked him why. He just didn't want to have any problems with the loan. He wanted to make sure everything was, checked again and make sure everything was good. Anyway, whereas another loan officer would turn a file to an LOA with docs from 8 months ago, pay stubs from 8 months ago, maybe not all the W-2s are there, maybe there's no bankruptcy papers, maybe there's none of the material documents are there. So when you have one loan officer sending a file, a little more well-prepared, as opposed to the other one that's sending in, with a lot less effort, that makes a difference in the amount of time the LOA has to spend working on the loan.
Is the LOA going to do that? Is it going to fill in the blanks for them?
That's what they've been doing.
Right. Yeah. What are they going to now moving forward?
I don't think there's anything in place just yet. What do you guys think?
That should all be done when you get wind that there's a submitting offer going about to go. That's when you need to kind of check for your paperwork, or even if you're staying in constant contact with your pre-quals, you know where they're at in the buying process. Okay, hey, don't forget to send updated documents, and obviously it's not going to be perfect, but it's something that you have to, kind of get better at and kind of have it as a muscle memory to say, okay, I always need updated documents as the month passes on, especially if they're becoming more serious when they're shopping.
Now, are you sending any submitting offers to Michelle to review, or?
Yeah, I am.
Okay. So she's scrubbing the file and then send out a list or whatever. Okay.
I would say if they're not doing it, then if you're sending it like the one I had that was 8-month-old check stubs, you might as well go ahead and ask for a 2-week amendment. It's almost a given. If the file's in that much disarray, they're gonna need at least a week, 10 days, 14, you know, that's already gonna push the loan back.
Well, that's why we're having the checklist, so we don't have that. I mean, to make sure that it doesn't, you know, that doesn't happen. Because that should happen.
What do you think?
Oh, yeah, you need updated docs before you send it into an LOA. I mean, not even, I wouldn't, if they were shopping for about a month and if they sent in the contract, that's fine. You know, if you have a month previous or maybe a month and a half previous documents, but if they're like 4 or 5 months behind on documents, then that's ridiculous.
Steven?
You agree?
Yeah. Lewis?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. In that meantime, you're going to keep in touch with them. You're going to know that they kept their employment, kept their income, you know, the same. So.
Yeah, we need now. Let me ask you this: if they're submitting an offer, because I mean, you got to keep in mind that the LOA was added there to add a benefit to loan officers to ease the workflow, right? So if the borrower is submitting an offer and you've already got most of the borrower's documents, how is that going to, you know, part of that was where they go scrub the file and they help you kind of make sure that you have everything in the file and then help organize it or whatnot. How do you foresee that relationship working if you've already pretty much got all the documents from the borrower?
The way I do it with Tyron is, you know, if I have a client submitting an offer and let's say they were 3 months, you know, I pre-qualified them 3 months ago and now they found the house. We have all the documents in. I'll send the file to them, but at the simultaneously, I'll request the new documents from the borrower so that he can get started on what he needs to do as far as the 1003, start preparing for, you know, the next steps as far as disclosures and all that, and then I can get the remaining documents. Now, if there's any discrepancy between what's in the file and what they're sending me, then we can address that up front. But that kind of knocks two birds out with one stone.
Okay.
So yeah, just so we're on the same page, when a contract comes in, it's going to go to the LOA and it's going to go to Mark. Disclosure is going to go out right away, and then before the loan goes in the processing, you might get a review from Mark, and that's basically your pass to go, you know, through the gate. And so and his goal, what we said, within 24 hours of receipt. So that means that's something that you have to stand by and make sure that we can commit to that. So if you get a contract at 3 o'clock, that by 3 o'clock the next day we have a review. It doesn't have to be unless it's in bad shape. It shouldn't be, but try to keep it, you know, clean and concise. You know.
Well, let me ask you this. Why wait till after the contract for Mark to do a review?
Huh?
Like, his review of the file should be done before the contract comes in. That way his last point of contact is checking the contract to make sure everything's solidified, and then connecting with the LOA to make sure all documents.
Well, we don't know if they're putting an offer, if the offer's going to be accepted.
Well, that's the LO's job.
Huh?
That's the LO's job to be on that.
Right, point. But what we're seeing is when contracts come in, they're 60% of them aren't done right, and they have the wrong close date and don't have concessions. And so the fact that that's the case, that can't go into processing. So just because someone's putting an offer doesn't mean they're going to go under contract. In fact, most of the time they don't.
But, so, I mean, going off of what Jason said, we could at least have Mark check the structure of the loan.
Whenever you're doing the pre-qual and the red light, that's what the structure is going to be checked. If you're checking structure at contract, then you should be, I mean, that's too late.
But I'm also thinking if there's another one more checkpoint.
Isn't that why we're checking the contract?
Hmm? No, but let's say that, for example, they put on there to remove all of the rotten wood and take out the dead cat on the contract. Mm-hmm. And no concessions, 2 days for closing, what we see 30% of the time. So, okay, if that goes in the process and no one's checked that, and now all this time's passed, now we got to get it fixed.
But he's looking at more than just the contract, right?
No, I understand that, but I'm just saying that, I mean, he's looking at, yes, he's checking it again to make sure everything looks okay. What if the person got a new job by the time I pre-qualified them, and now they're on a commission-only job, and the loan officer didn't think about that, you know?
Right.
So what if that happens? What if something changes?
That's what I was worried about with that one.
What if credit expires and you have to pull a new credit report and now the score dropped? What if there's an account just now that's in dispute? I mean, this stuff happens.
Shouldn't you look at that when they tell you that they're going to put an offer in?
I mean, I do think that they have a valid point. If you're doing a submitting offer, doing a two-step process, go review the contract, take a couple minutes, okay, look, you got to get rid of this, and you know what I mean? And instead of it being a longer review.
Yeah.
And if he does that submitting offer, they're going back getting more stuff in the bar anyway. You know what I mean? So now you have him reviewing it. They already went back, got stuff in the bar, and then you have the scrub from the LOA, and you have him reviewing going back, so you probably hit the bar two or three times. You know what I'm saying? You could have hit him once if you did it at submitting offer. It's just
now, the thing is that if you think about that, though, because you have some people that are at different stages.
Well, but then that's when you just stop the whole different stages, and it can be a set standard. This is the procedure, especially if they're new. I think regardless of different stages, the process should be standard. I don't care if you've been here 12 years or you've been here 12 days.
I'm about to stand up, Jason.
That's amazing, Jason.
No, I mean, but on a serious note, it has to be that way because you got new guys submitting files that crap is crap. Ooh. If it ain't structured right, because they don't know what the hell you're doing. And then now it holds up everybody else's good money. And so instead of closing 3 weeks early, we close on time.
We made him a believer, guys.
I'll be there Sunday morning, man.
that's good. That's exactly what that's exactly why we're doing all this. So,
wow.
The problem is that there's people that don't follow the system. That's where things break.
But then that's why you take their ass off from doing pre-approvals.
I agree with you 100%. Damn. There's a couple. So.
Put him beside me, man. Let me...
No, I don't think we want
that. At least the fireworks, but I'm just saying.
Tonight it'll be something else.
Yeah, we can, you can have that to where, you review it, when they're submitting an offer.
Well, I am. As far as what Jason said, it is. And I think that's where some of the breakdown is
they have to notify you on the board when they're submitting an offer, right?
Right. When I go to Velocify, it should say submitting offer.
The LOA should be able to review the contracts, or they should be held accountable for that.
I'm gonna say that I would not believe that somebody submitted an offer if
close date
if they hadn't talked to him since September of last year.
Close date and concessions and things like that impact the loan. Sometimes a new loan officer is scared to get asked for concessions, so they accept whatever comes in on the contract.
But that's the realtor's job, right?
No, it's the LO's job.
It's the LO's job.
Be the real job.
So
it's all your job.
When Mark is doing the submitting offer, when he looks through the file and we look at income, we look at assets, then it should be clarified right there and there. Okay, look, they need 5 or 6 concessions,
right?
Or money, whatever, and this is the close date that we need to expect. That way, it gives everybody enough time to look like we know what the heck we're doing.
The person told me.
We go down to the pre qualification email that we send out to the customer. Hey, you need 5% concession.
If you send it out at that time too, the realtor sometimes will.
Yeah, they don't.
Because you can just add it, so the realtor will. Hey, this is how much I need to offer concession.
No,
this is how much
is
you need.
The thing is that if you put that on the
never mind.
If you put that on the approval letter and you don't know that realtor, and you don't explain that to them and talk to them, then they're gonna think that you're overcharging the customer. And so they're going to think, why do you need 5% concessions? Because you remember that unless you're dealing with a realtor that does a lot of government lending, they're not going to understand that because conventional loans don't have concessions.
They don't understand a borrower that doesn't want to bring $1 to closing.
Yeah. And conventional, like a regular realtor, it's 20% down, you pay for your own closing costs. When you hear 6% concessions, they don't understand that. So if you're working with your realtors, go ahead and put that on the letter. But if you're not working with, if it's a new realtor, they're not going to know why are you doing this. I've lost about probably 500 loans because I put 6% concessions, and I wonder why the realtor and the customer never called me back. And then I found out later they thought that I was ripping the customer off. And so they don't know. So I never put concessions on the approval letter.
It depends on the dynamics of the loan. If you have a low credit score FHA and it's in, you know, Pennsylvania and they want zero cash to close, I mean, you're gonna need more concessions because the borrower's asset position is only barely enough for the down payment. And the realtor uses that as leverage to take them somewhere else because they're like, hey, you don't need this much in concessions, we can do the loan without that. But the realtor's not really considering the fact this is what the person's credit score is, this is what the rate pricing is gonna be, so they're not gonna have benefit of any type of rate credit. You know what I mean? Savvy?
No, savvy. An expiration date on the approval.
Yeah, you should have one.
Does everybody?
Yeah, you should have an expiration date on there.
Oh, I don't know.
Talking about my income, Josh told me a situation.
Approval letter should have an expiration on there. Should be good.
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't have an expiration.
You gotta add it.
I thought it did have it on there.
It's never ending.
Forever.
That's why they come in like 6-8 months later.
Yeah. I know.
I still got this pre-approval letter from last year.
For 100 years.
It's a two-month expiration.
Going back to their Google email, searching for it. Where's that one?
So, Mark, you're gonna be reviewing offers now?
But
add that to the board?
If you have an expiration.
Okay, but is it on your board? How do you, is there a formal way? Are you actually?
It's on the board.
Should be pre-qual, contract, and submitting offer. Those three things.
I would just say that if you have a loan submitting offer, instead of just the contract, just you want to get that ahead of time. You know what I mean? And LOAs make sure that they get on that board to help make sure, remind the loan officer
so
that.
If I start skipping
when
around,
you get a new file,
in order to,
you remind them that, hey, let's make sure we get a second set of eyes on this before the contract comes in too.
Okay, so that's some good stuff we talked about. Now, lastly, what I want to talk about, Andrew, I brought something to my attention on Friday.
One more thing.
Oh, you got something else?
On the income, the last time we talked about this, when we first introduced it, it was several had said, well, we don't need the overtime, we don't need the bonus. Josh told me a situation happened in processing, and it was, I don't know who the loan officer was, but taxes went up quite a bit a month. Is that right, Josh? And the overtime was already in place. So the mistake, though, that probably saved a week.
What was that?
It could have saved a week. The taxes went up when processing went in, they got the tax cert from title. The taxes had gone up, or the taxes were more than what was disclosed.
Right.
And
the taxes were double, overtime was like 60% less?
Taxes was double, overtime was...
You told me the overtime was already in place.
Yeah, what was input versus what was technically actually in the file? I mean, what was input was actually accurate, was actually like, it was only 30% of what they inputted. That's how much overtime was.
Okay, so 70% less?
70% less.
This is in New York, the taxes were inputted at 350, they're actually like 700.
Mm-hmm.
So it didn't work.
The loan does not work.
Okay, I thought you had said that it was in, the overtime was already in place. It had already been calculated, and that there was a different situation.
Maybe it's a different issue. I don't know.
But anyway, that's the reason why to go ahead and get the overtime. Go ahead and figure all the variables. Do it up front, because then when it gets to processing, you've already got an escape. You've already got a.
And we talked about it last night in the income training. Where the borrower has $8,000 in earnest money in that transaction.
Okay. All right. So. The other thing that lastly we want to talk about real quick is, Andrew and I were talking on Friday and about a chief challenge or complaint here on the loan officer, taking control of the steering wheel with the customer and setting the right expectations. I think he's a few case studies or examples he wants to illustrate. On why it's so important to for the loan officer to you're the one that controls the transaction. If you let the customer, and a lot of you guys that are new, if you're letting the customer tell you what to do or the realtor, and then you lose credibility as the expert. So you have to stay in control. If it's 45 days, it's 45 days. If it's 3%, it's 3%. Okay. If you need to pay this down, you can't go under contract yet, I know you need to get out of the apartment and you want the house, that's what we're doing. If you start bending on that and you let them take control, then it's gonna be hard to get other things from them later that you need that are pertinent to the loan process. And so so he's gonna talk about that. And one thing I do wanna say that no matter what, You need to keep the customer and the realtor in control. Don't ever bash the company or a fellow team member when you're working with them. If something doesn't go right, don't blame someone. Oh, this person screwed up, it's their fault. Don't do that. Okay. So you need to take responsibility, but don't blame other people. So okay, Andrew, you want to come over here and talk about this?
Honestly, like, we've been getting a lot of files just in general where customers just been coming in and demanding stuff from us and then pushing everything off on us. And it's just honestly, buyer expectations that you guys need to set off. And there's everybody's really good. There's just a few of these files that's coming in. If those few files comes in, what's gonna happen is we have to spend more time. Originally, we could spend like 20 or 30 minutes with a customer on the phone. Now we're gonna have to spend an hour trying to talk to the customer, trying to get information, trying to get docs and stuff like that, when they're fighting you on the entire way. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, Danny's files. Danny's files been coming into me, it's been perfect. Like, a customer comes in and they understand that they have a need, okay? That they that we can fulfill that need. And they will follow my, like, everything I ask to exact T. And for a very good example, this is a file that, it's Mark Lewis's. This customer right here came to me, it came to us, and we literally closed them in, I think, 20-something days, almost 30 for Finch. Mm-hmm. 30-something, like less than 30 days. And the customer, when we asked them to rewrite a DROG letter, okay? This customer, like, don't know who I am, don't have any kind of obligation to me whatsoever, but he had the correct expectation set in his mind that when he wrote it, this is the thing that actually is pretty good. Where is it right here? Let me start by saying I was a very young man when I took out these loans and acquired these debts. They were small loans that eventually added up and I could not afford them. I do not even remember what I even purchased. And then he keeps on going to this. And he even called himself, like, he was dumb, but he grew up. And now I have obligations that I have to fulfill for my family. He literally called himself dumb in a letter to the underwriter. I mean, how many customers can say that?
None.
That's just correct expectations. Like, this is to the extreme, but I'm just saying.
Talk bad about yourself.
I know. You literally did. If you guys want to read this
but,
is actually.
But what's the point, though?
I think the thing is that.
The point is, honestly, like, if we have customers right here that comes in expect that they get everything, they demand everything. If they come over here demanding everything from us and telling us, like, what they want us to do, that we're going to do it, that we can make things happen for them. And I had a customer right here a few days ago, like, okay, we're supposed to close February, okay, at the beginning of February. Everything's already done. When we call for PVOE, the guy actually lost his job in December 31st and just didn't want to tell us about it and think, like, oh, we can skim it under the carpet. He didn't have trust in us. He didn't trust in the LO. He didn't have trust in us. And he thinks that he can just, whatever he does, we're just going to give him a loan. That's not going to happen. We're saving the deal, though. But I'm just saying, to the end of the point, like, he didn't trust us. And he didn't know that we're the authority in this. You guys know everything about the loan. They don't know anything about it. It's like somebody coming into your field and telling you how it's going to be done. Is that how it's supposed to be? It's like, if I'm a doctor, I'm going to come in here. If I'm a doctor and a patient comes in and tell me, hey, I need this, 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 and this. Does a doctor say, oh, okay, I'm just going to give it to you? Or the doctor tells you, like, hey, man, this is my job. I know what I'm doing. I studied for this. And you should listen to my orders. You see what I'm saying in this?
Yeah, it's a good analogy.
Yeah, Josh tells me this every single day and tells us every single day. If we get, honestly, the loans that we've been getting has been getting better and better and better, but we gotta keep on improving on that to the point that it can come into my office and, like, what he says. When it comes into processing, we're supposed to be getting done at FHA in 3 weeks, USDA about 4 weeks. We can get all these stuff done. And we've been getting better and better at meeting our goals and moving these loans along faster and faster, to the point that we can hit earlier deadlines and stuff like that. But it's not just us hitting our deadlines, about you guys giving a loan to us and letting the customer know what kind of expectations to accept. Don't give us a customer that's gonna make it difficult for us, because if one customer comes in like that, it's gonna back up everybody's loans. It's gonna make it longer for us to close each and every other loan. And that's pretty much all I have to say. Just set correct expectations for them, and then we're gonna knock these things out the ballpark for you guys as fast as possible.
Can you give some examples where you wouldn't set correct expectations? Yeah. Specific examples?
All right.
I knew it.
It's not her, but it's just the customer in general.
I want this to be crystal clear. I don't want to have any, you know, vagaries about it. We have some new people here, and they may not know what we're talking about.
But there's another customer
that came in. He's coming in, is actually from New York State, and this guy just comes in here. I mean, honestly, the guy's a nice guy, but the customer just comes over here thinking that he knows everything. And, like, he is expecting me to do everything for him. And, like, it's just, he's just trying to bully everybody by saying, and try to threaten us and tell us, like, oh, man, if you can't do it, we're going to take it to another loan. We looked at the file. You can't go anywhere. We understand this. Like, when we get the file, it's literally like we're looking into your life. It's honestly the truth. Mm-hmm. With the file, right, I mean, statistically speaking, if I look at a guy's bank statements, there's a math equation for it, okay? It tells you the likelihood of what kind of spending you're going to be, what kind of future you're going to have. There's actually MIT did a retired research on this, that when you're looking at somebody's bank report and looking at where he's spending, how he's spending it, and how much money that he's saving and what's average, it can tell a person, like, where's it going to be 3 years, 5 years, 10 years down the line. So when we technically receive a file.
Food's going to stop, man.
Yeah. But when we're reviewing this file, in general, we can see every single thing of the customers. We know what we're looking at, and our job is to make sure that we know what kind of customer they are. Like, when we look at the report, we have it. So they can try to lie to us as much as they want, but we know what's going on. That's what we're supposed to be doing each and every single day. So so we just have to set the correct expectation in their mind right away of what they have to do to get this loan.
Okay, so basically what that means specifically, the loan officer should tell the customer, hey, listen, you have a 600 FICO score. Listen, we want to help you. We specialize in this. No one else is going to do your loan, but you have to have these items in. Yeah. You have to have the 2 months bank statements. You have to have the verified funds. You have to write these letters out. I can't have any static on this, or otherwise I can't help you. Like, and you know, that's like he said about the doctor. If you start yelling at the doctor is just going to kick you out. He's not going to even give you a second. And the doctor said, this is what you have to do. Either you take it or you leave it. Right? We talk about Tim Grover and Relentless. You either take it or you leave it, you're out. You want to be part of the team, then you need to follow this regimen. There's no emotion to this. This is what you're going to do. Okay? You're going to run 5-6 miles a day. You're going to shoot 1,500 jumpers, and you're just going to do it, or I'm not going to train you. It's the same thing here. I'm not going to train you if you can't follow this regimen. I'm not going to do your loan for you. Now you want to be polite and professional, but I'd rather not do the loan. And I've turned many good loans away where the deal mates, you know, the deal was there, but the guy was a jerk. I'm not going to deal with that, man. Just to close someone's loan, I'm not going to have somebody push me around like that, man.
Thank you, client.
And so, you know, so just the point is that I just want to make sure we're clear on these things, as it's not confusing on what we're talking about. Because if you take that hot potato and you throw it in the processing, you're putting a lot of stress on the system. Okay?
I'm actually going to straight up say this. If you guys know who B is, who remembers B?
Yeah.
He threw me under the bus.
Threw you under the bus?
He threw me under the bus.
What?
Yeah. B threw me under the bus. Well, he was the bus, but I'm just saying.
He still watches all our YouTube videos, by the way.
Hi, B. Why you throw me over?
I mean, they're not private, but,
Is he commenting on
it? I'm sure he's learning.
Disliking? Oh, no, that's where all the dislikes go.
What is it that you're trying to say, though, on that?
Remember we said a second ago, like, don't put hot potato on somebody else?
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Did he give you a loan?
That loan.
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah. So. Me too. Okay. So, basically, you know, when Josh talks about this all the time, it's just real important that you stay in control. Does everyone understand that? You have to stay in control of the customer. Don't let them control you. So.
What's two most important things a loan officer can do? Everyone except for Mark. Mark, go ahead.
Well, I thought you were going to ask me a question.
It is quite well. I mean, you know,
for structure and expectation.
Right. So that's all that is expectations and a structuring loan. If you do that, I mean, your loans go right through. You can fill up a pipeline, pretty big, and you know, be able to maintain it. You can't maintain a pipeline if those things aren't in place. You know, $2-3 million pipe or whatever. You have to have those two things in place. Because if you're telling every borrower, I'm going to get back the same day, whether you're a 600 credit score, 700 credit score, and your pipeline fills up and you have 10 apps to process, everything is going to break. Mm-hmm. It's going to break at the seams. So you have to have it under control. And that's by letting customers know, look, I mean, you're going to get something back in 3 to 4 days from now. This customer is going to get something back, you know, next week we hear something, we'll get back to you at this time. And when you go into processing, don't give them any slack. Whatever they ask you for, they need it that day or the next day. You know what I mean? You got to tell, set those expectations up early and keep that borrower under control. If it's a wild person, like her deal, you want to get him in check right away. You know, like if we're going to work together, this is how it's going to be. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we're going to have a problem because there's going to be a lot more of this. There's going to be a lot more of you getting documents throughout the rest of the process. It's not just this. And then when I pass you off to my associate, you know, we're going to make sure that, you know, you have mutual respect for them and you talk to them in a professional manner. Yep. You know,
yeah,
if you start screaming and yelling at me or any of my associates, we're going to have to cancel out your loan because we won't tolerate that. We can't provide service to somebody that talks to us like that. You know what I mean? I say that a lot. I just realized that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. What's the payoff for this? What's the reward? Why do we do that?
Faster process, more money.
Right. So these, now you guys just, you know, they just came back from Vegas. They met some big time loan officers, right? Is that the direction you guys are headed? Mm-hmm. So that's the reward. So that's the reward for you if you do well. You know, you met guys that are closing $5 million a month, $4 million a month.
50 million a year.
A year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There was a guy, and then one guy closed with 5 or 6, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's what it is. You're building
team.
You're building. You know, that's the thing. Yes, that's what it is. And so you have to build and get there.
System.
And he's turning in good quality loans.
Okay. Oh.
So he's not. He doesn't turn in something that's cut and paste. I mean, it's, you know, it's a good clean loan, and he's perceived as the expert. So if you can do the math, see how much money that guy's making. And so,
800 something.
Yeah. So and that's the thing. that's the type of opportunities that are available for the right people. That's what we're building here. With, you know, some of you guys will get there. Some of you won't. It's just the statistics and so the facts about it. So, you know, we do our best to make sure that you guys have all the tools. You probably have more than anyone that I know of, everything that you have. And so, you know, but it's just a matter of application now. You know, and you have it, now you have to implement all these things, and it takes time. You know, it's a process. It takes time to grow it, just like it takes time to grow a flower. You can't force that growth, you know. And so, you know, even if you put in more time, that can help to expedite it. Like Elon Musk talks about, you can do a 100-hour work week increase your results, but some things, they just take time. And so, and a lot of people here are on track. But this is a main component of it. If you turn in good loans, they're going to close in 2 or 3 weeks. If you prospect and build a huge pipeline, that's a key part. That's the number one thing I tell you guys is prospecting.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, more important than closing is prospecting. You need to have a huge funnel, huge. If you don't have a huge funnel, it won't get down to the bottom. You know, and so that's a very, very important thing. So anyway, that's all that we want to talk about today. So we'll let you get back to doing what you're doing.
Jason.